Welcome to Emily's garden. Come on out today. Welcome to Emily's garden. Just a snap away. In this place, life is celebrated. It's the place where dreams are cultivated. Welcome to Emily's garden, just a snap away.
My name is Emily. Welcome to my garden. It's the place where dreams are cultivated. I have a great show planned for you today. Join me in the backyard. This show is dedicated to our fine-feathered friends. While we normally think of birdhouses as a way to protect nature and increase the amount of birds in our area, that was not always the case. Birdhouses in some places in Europe were used initially as a trap to capture eggs and even birds. However, the good news is, in most cases, birdhouses have been used to protect wild birds from harsh weather and predators for centuries. The American birdhouse finds its roots from the native Indians, who in turn taught the English and German immigrants moving to the East Coast of the United States. There are two kinds of cavity nesters, those that create their own nesting cavities and those that use pre-existing cavities often found in trees and such. And so, some birds look for nesting cavities to build their nests. Songbirds, for example, are not capable of creating their own nesting cavities because their beaks are specialized for hunting insects or gathering seeds. Making a birdhouse designed specifically for the favored bird is key to success. Bird species prefer different nesting conditions, you see, whether it's the size of the entrance hole or even the height that the birdhouse is placed off of the ground. I have a few projects to show you that I dare say will bring a smile to any bird's face. You can make some great birdhouses from gourds grown right in your garden. As you can see, I'm surrounded by some really nice gourds. I painted quite a few, just some rich colors that I thought might be pleasant in your yard, and I want to show you how to make them. These have been left to cure, but I have to tell you, you can grow these in your garden. They're quite easy to grow. Gourds will grow in most climate zones, but they grow best in warm weather. And if you're in a location that receives freezing temperature throughout most of the winter, start them indoors. Keeping in mind, you'll need to start your seeds 6 to 8 weeks before the last frost. Gourds take about 180 days from planting to producing ripe fruit, you see. Select a planting location in full sunlight with plenty of space for the gourds to sprawl, or just stake out trellises for them to grow upright. Once you've grown, dried, and cured your gourds, that's when the fun begins. There are two basic types that are grown and used decoratively. that is, soft-skinned and hard-skinned.
For thousands of years, gourds have been grown and used as useful utensils.
Soft-skinned gourds are colorful and grow in odd, fun shapes that are often used in fall decorations. They can also be dried and saved, although their bright colors will begin to fade in a few months. But a little paint will take care of that.
The hard-skinned gourds include birdhouse, bottle, and dipper gourds.
Their color remains green on the vine and eventually turn to shades of tan and brown as they dry. Drying ornamental gourds does require time, and there are no shortcuts. Start by cleaning the surface of them with soapy water and allow to air dry by placing them in a well-ventilated area away from direct sunlight, where they can remain for at least 6 months. When the gourds become light and solidly hard, you can hear the seeds rattling inside when you shake them, letting you know they're ready for use.
You're gonna need a drill and a hole saw with a mandrel. So we will start. Leave the gourds on the vine until they have reached their full size, and that will vary. As you can see, there are all different types of gourds. This is the dipper gourd, and this is one of my favorites. I got this quite a few years ago. It's an apple gourd. Besides making birdhouses, you can see with all the shapes how creative that you can be with them. After a while, they're almost like wood, and you'll see that when I start to drill. I've seen some that have been carved, stained, and as I said earlier, you can make utensils out of them, hence the dipper gourd. If you made a larger hole here and turned it upright without the perch that I made, you could actually use that to dip. Let's see if that would work. Okay, you have to imagine it without the stick. I think so. So after they have cured and dried and you have washed them down, you might want to sand them. All of these have been sanded. They are quite old and you're going to see how hard they are. Some of them are a little bit softer than others. I can feel that this one's going to be a little bit of a chore when I take to drilling. The first thing that I like to do when I get my drill out, I like to do the hole first. So I have to change bits. So once you have your hole saw set, you're ready to go. What I like to do is to try to position where I want the hole. And this is where I really need to tell you that different size holes will attract different size birds. Half of life is really just some common sense. So here we go. I'm going to find a spot that I like, and I think on this one I'm going to go right about yay. So here we go. You want to make sure that it's nice and firm. You can crack these too, so you have to use a little caution. Voila! As simple as that. I love doing this. And now you can hear the seeds. Let's do the other one and we'll talk a little bit about the seeds.
Gourd seeds are infamous for their tough outer shell, which is partly responsible for their extra long germination period. But you can soak them in a bowl of lukewarm water 24 hours before planting to help speed up the process. After the gourds are planted, leave them on the vine until they have reached their full size. Bearing in mind that curing time will vary from gourd to gourd depending on its size and therefore water content.
Okay. like so. I painted these all one color in the interest of time, quite frankly, for the show. But if you wanted to, I mean, let your imagination go crazy. What do you see in this gourd? You could paint it to be a goose. Bunch of things, I would think. Okay, let's find where we want the hole. I'm gonna say right about yay. Okay, down we go. And gotta have a steady hand. That one was a mite harder. And you know what? If it's not perfect, all the better, I say. There you have it. Now, what's going to happen? We're not going to take these seeds out yet, so I can clear the table when we get to that part. We're going to take off the hole saw by going like this and opening that little hole. Simple as that. And then we're going to take a drill bit, put that in, like so. Until that's all closed in. All right. Now, again, you can use different size bits. This just happens to be what I have on hand. So guess what? That's what we're using. You have to understand that these are going to be out in the weather. So you want to make some drainage holes first in the bottom. And I like to put three. I'm just going to kind of hold this. And one. That'd be two. And three. We don't want water collecting in them. And then this is also something that you really have to take into consideration. When you go to hang these, you want them to hang straight. They can be hung with wire, as I have done here. And I'll be honest with you, the reason I did the wire as opposed to the string was I found that after a while I started to paint myself into a corner, and the wire allowed me to hold it much better than the string did. So we'll probably do the same thing here, because I want to show you a couple of different methods when you wire them. Some of them can be very intricate, and I'll bring down a few when we get there. In the meantime, you want to kind of see where it's weighted. So I think that if I put it in the neck right about here, I think it's going to be just about right. So for this one, I'm going to lay down, because I'm going to actually go straight through. Okay, so here we go. Again, try to be steady. Right through. So we know that we have a straight shot through on each side, and it's going to hang right about like that. And again, the wire will give you a little bit more flexibility than the string would. We're going to put this one down, complete the other holes that we need on this one, and then we're going to talk a little bit more about the inside. Okay, here we go again. One, two, and three. Okay. And this one still has some of the vine on it, which I actually find very attractive. I try not to cut them all. Now, I could go way down here if I wanted to, but I'm not. I'm going to go up to the top because I won't need quite as much wire. Now, you'll notice that that didn't go straight through because the drill actually will not reach the circumference. So I'm going to have to eyeball this one. Seeds are coming out. And that's okay, because that's the next thing I want to show you. There, we have it. And before I put the drill away and we do go on to talk a little bit more about the seeds themselves and what's inside, I want to put another drill hole right here. You know, I had a great summer of taking footage around the yard, and I was very lucky to capture on film the birds actually feeding their young ones. And notice that the bird feeder that was homemade, actually by my brother, thank you very much, has a perch on it, and that really helped them. So although you could make these without the perch, I took a little lesson from watching those birds. So I'm going to put a pole right on the bottom, and again, it can be here, it could be on the side, it could be whatever is creative enough for you. Now, I went down pretty far here. I will put it down a little bit further, but again, you want to take into consideration all of these holes before you do bare them with the saw, because it might make a difference in how it's going to hang. I'm going to put a dowel in there. So the weight of it will be a little bit different. It will be distributed a little bit differently. If I put it over on the side, same thing. Okay, that being said and done, so there's your hole for your perch. Do the same with this one. This one's a little bit easier. And I'm telling you, this one is very, very hard. So it might take a little bit more strength to push through it, but that's okay. I think I can handle it. Okay. Again, we are subject to the size hole that I'm using with this drill bit. Let me show you the dowels. You can pick these up at almost any hardware or lumber store. Cut them to the lengths that you want. I pretty much, again, just eyeballed these last night when I cut them. But what I want to mention is they can come out as small or as long as you want, or they can go straight through, so there's actually even a little perch inside. They will nest in here, so they're going to end up putting other materials inside the gourd. And And I can see that that hole was not big enough, but I have a remedy. A little bit more. A little bit more. See if we can snake this in now. Oh yeah. That's working. Okay, so we have gotten this far. I'm going to also check this hole. This is the one that is a little bit more tender. It's not quite as hard as that one, so I don't want to crack it. Let's see if I can. Nope, needs to be a little bigger. Not that big. It's fine. And this is where I might go all the way in. Nothing's a mistake. All the way in now. And of course this would be glued when we're all done. But for now, let's go to the next step. I'm going to take these out for a minute. So I want to show you what's inside, and you can see that some of the seeds have actually fallen. So then you got to get your fingers in there, and there are membranes, because remember, gourds are related to the squash family and pumpkins. Now if you've ever carved a pumpkin, you know what all that pulp is like inside. Same thing with the gourds. Except now these are dried, so they're hard, not mushy. So it might take a little doings to get them all out. Just shake them up and let her rip, just like so. And you don't have to be that particular to get them all out, because, believe it or not, the seeds and the pulp really will be the first meal for your birds. You can soak the seeds for up to 24 hours before planting them to help the germination period along, just like very many other hard-shelled seeds, like morning glories. Okay, let me clean up this mess a little bit so that we can finish the process of making the birdhouses. That's much better. Now we have some area to work with for the next phases. You can see that I've put on the table some paint, and you do want to make sure that you stir it up really, really good. You can see that a lot of this paint's been sitting around for a while, but it's still good. And I brought out some wire. As I said, you can also use string if you want to. But I wanted to show you a couple of different ways that you could do this, depending on what type of a gourd that you're working with. Here we go. And another. And I'm going to do one more, because I do want to show you why I like the wire better than the string. Okay. Obviously, you have to go through this. So, it's pretty straightforward, because we did make these holes line up. You can also see how hard that would be to get through with the twine, unless you maybe used a needle with a large eye, you might be able to do it if it would reach over that far. This just makes it a lot easier when we paint too. So I'm going to bend this. You can clean it up a little bit when you're done. You can twist it around so this doesn't show it's inside, but we won't bother with that right now. Now the reason that I cut two of these, I'm going to put this gourd aside for a little bit because we're probably not going to use it. However, I am going to take one of these gourds down to show you why it's also a good reason to use wire. When I drilled the holes in this one, I couldn't really go across unless I wanted to go way down here. So I drilled the holes in the top, like so, which did pose a problem, because how do I get the wire in? What I decided would be the best method was to insert the wire inside, feel for it. There it is. So now that I have done that, what I would do is simply wind this up a little bit so it's bigger than the hole and pull it out like that, and then find the other and do the same. Solve that problem, didn't it? You can still do the same thing with a string. That's basically it. Pretty easy. Let's hang you back up so we can show the next part. These gourds have been washed, dried, and sanded. You should always wear gloves, as my brother would say, in my case, when I go out. I have got the worst hands, but my hands have served me well. They do lots of things. They're not the most attractive, but hey. So here we go. Again, you want to make sure that you stir up your paint, dip your brush, like so, And this really is the fun part. And I like the contrast of the stick. You can paint the stick. It's all creativity, whatever option that you want to do. And just begin to paint it. And you can start to see a whole new life come on to these gourds. And like I said before, I've seen these stained and carved and, oh my God, the most wonderful things. Just paint that through. Like so. I'll only do the front side so that you can see. My little tendrils that I wanted to keep are getting in the way, but that's all right. Even if they get a little color on them, it won't hurt none. Like so. And again, you can paint where it was cut off the vine if you want to, and paint the vine itself, but I just like that contrast. Even if you get a little bit on it, it's not going to make any difference. And one thing I did notice with these last night, they drip. So you want to hang them in a place. I ended up hanging them on my clothesline. And two coats is nice if you can do two coats. Some of the, actually all of these only have one coat right now, but I used a glossy paint. Once you get to this point, you have this wire that you can hold, which is much more sturdy than the string. Okay, I'm just going to put this down for 1 second. We won't finish painting it here. I think you get the idea. I have a few more projects to show you, as if this wasn't enough, but I think you'll really like these. So what I'm going to do is clean this table off one more time. Here we go, all set for the last of our projects today. There are all kinds of bird feeders that you can make out of ordinary things. I'm pretty well known at this point for potting up my boots. I have them all over the yard. And another way that you can use them is if you nail them to a tree. There's a nice little cavity in the boot itself, and they're cute. So that's a pretty easy project to do. And you see these in the store sometime, the little grapevine balls. Same thing. You want to make a little hole in these as well so the birds can get in. Hang these in and about your yard, and there's another nice little nest for them. Up until now, we have really just concentrated on bird houses. But you know, you might be able to pick up some of these suet feeders, which is, of course, more of a feeder than a house. They drop right in, and there are a lot of recipes online, which I didn't include with this show today. I thought this was quite enough, thank you very much. And of course, that's all you do, and hang it up. If you don't have any suet, and I know if you're like me, you end up with stale bread, I'll throw it on the ground, but this is also a nice way to help it from disintegrating too fast before the birds get a chance to get to it. So remember that. If you see these suet feeders, pick up a few. They have a lot of uses. One of the things that I like to do, take some yarn. You want them to be 6 to 8 inches long, and you put these in the suet feeders. Of course, not for them to eat, but as you know, in the spring, they go to gathering materials for their nests. They just pull this out, and before you know it, you will have nature's tapestries all around your yard. That being said and done, we part until we meet again. See you next time here in Emily's Garden.